Bengawan Solo,
river of love, behold, where the palms are swaying low and lovers their souls unfold.
If you live in Asia, or perhaps have been introduced to the songs of your grandparents' youth, then you might have heard this song before. It's a song that has been exported into multiple Asian countries and languages, from Singapore to Japan. If you're a cinephile, then you might have heard this song in some older films or period pieces.
Hello， 周生唔喺度啊，佢翻咗工，有冇咩事话要交代啊
？Bengawan Solo is a song written and composed by Gesang Maruto Hartono, an Indonesian musician born in Surakarta, October 1, 1917. He composed the song in 1940, just before the Japanese invasion, which lasted 3 years from 1942 to 1945. Before we discuss the history, conception, and subsequent international proliferation of the song, we must take a brief look at Indonesia's history. Okay, we definitely won't bore you with an entire history class here, but to summarize the history of Indonesia's modern, post-kingdoms era, it is one of colonization, exploitation, and oppression. While there have been other colonial powers that have taken claim parts of the archipelago, the Dutch dominated the most area and the longest. At first came the Dutch East India Company, or the VOC, in the 1600s, which exploited the region for its resources and land. After the company was abolished in the late 1700s, the Dutch government formally took control over the territory, naming it Netherlands East Indies. And then, after further history unfolded, World War II came, and through various circumstances, which included the Japanese Empire having a far more advanced military, Japan seized control of the colony in 1942. This is where the story of Gesang Maruto Hartono, Kroncong music, and the song Bengawan Solo started. In the late era of the Netherlands East Indies, Gesang Maruto Hartono was one of the many musicians creating songs in an era which saw the advent of radio stations and the motion picture. In this time period, young musicians in bands would create pop songs inspired by Western styles like jazz and swing, with some musicians also popularizing the Kroncong genre. Kroncong itself was a style of music that interpolated the Portuguese, who brought this genre of sentimental songs to the region. Many of these songs were in the Malay language, such as the famous Terang Bulan. However, there was a distinct lack of songs in the budding new Indonesian language, Bahasa Indonesia, a gap which Maruto Hartono took to himself as an opportunity to create songs about Indonesia in Indonesian. One of those songs was, of course, Bengawan Solo, a sentimental and poignant poem to the Solo River in Jawa. As the Dutch left and Japan took over, they brought a new agenda to the table. Japan had a pan-Asian vision for a greater East Asia co-prosperity sphere, and their propaganda slogan for the colonies was Asia for Asians, which also morphed into Asian Art for Asians, where they would emphasize cultural policies that would spread the influence of Japan in Greater Asia through censorship of approved literature and art. The Japanese oppressors would encourage any art, music, and plays that reflected this Asian Art for Asians policy.
Seperangan Asia Timur Raya, seperjuangan, sehidup semati dengan Dai Nippon. Nomor dua, kita mendirikan negara Indonesia yang merdeka sebagai anggota dalam lingkungan keluarga Asia Timur Raya. Lima, kita berjuang ke arah perdamaian dunia menurut dasar Hakko Ichiu.
The yet-to-be-independent Indonesia were temporarily freed from one oppressor, only to find themselves under the grip of another power. And yet, this brief respite from Dutch rule provided a space to reflect on their collective identity. It is quite ironic that through empowering artists and the arts to emphasize the uniqueness of one's Asian homeland, it led people to conjure an image of collective memory and a sense of proto-nationalism and yearning for revolutionary independence, rather than integrating with Japan's fancied Asian empire. At the time, political movements from Dr. Sukarno, who spoke on radios and at venues, albeit delivering pro-Japanese rhetorics, would also sow the seeds for nationalism. He would later be the country's first president. Bengawan Solo would slowly gain traction as it spread through villages in Jawa and throughout Indonesia by way of Japanese-run radio stations that would only allow Japanese and Indonesian songs to be broadcast, which would amplify its dissemination. Bengawan Solo is a special song that owes its success to its late interpretations. While the lyrics speak of the beauty and splendor of the Solo River in Jawa, it brings forth imagery of an all-encompassing homeland, or Tanah Air, which translates to soil and water. The melody washes over you with the feeling of a flowing river and nostalgic breeze, something that all future international versions of the song would retain despite many different translations. The song also essentially brings forth a universal sense of nostalgia for an imagined heyday, which affects not only Indonesia, but also other Asian countries who have their own version. Keroncong, the style that Bengawan Solo was originally written for, as mentioned before, mixed Portuguese and Indonesian elements. But the style also interacted with Arabic and Chinese culture. This mix of origins embodied Indonesia's national message of unity in diversity at that time, and encapsulated the budding nation's pluralism. After the Japanese surrendered to the Allies on August 15, 1945, a power vacuum was created in Indonesia, and revolutionaries like Sukarno seized the opportunity to finally declare Indonesia's independence. Despite the Dutch re-entering the country and further military struggle until 1949, for all intents and purposes, the self-determination of the country was enshrined forever in 1945. This is where the story of Bengawan Solo's international proliferation truly began. There are two important areas we must discuss if we want to understand its iconic worldwide status. One, how it was integrated into Japanese pop culture and its subsequent Japanization. And two, how so many songwriters in Asia created their own version of the song. First, let's discuss how Japan brought Bengawan Solo home. Since the song played in Japanese-run radios in Indonesia, many Japanese soldiers ingrained the song into their hearts with sentimental nostalgia. In 1944, musician Ichiro Fujiyama transcribed the song and brought it back to Japan a year later. The first notable commercial version of the song in Japan was by singer Toshi Matsuda, using the Japanese translation of Bengawan Solo or Bengawan Solo, as it came to be known in Japan. The song was more high-pitched and interpolated the Japanese military music style of gunka in its instruments. Japan deserves a special mention here, as their version of the song was inextricably linked to their colonization and imperial ambition, because the way they chose to remember the song was not through the lens of nostalgia for their homeland, nor simply admiration for the Solo River. No, it was remembered through a lens of militaristic and imperial sentimentality and yearning for the jewel that was Jawa, and a colony that was lost. The commercial version of the song quickly became highly popular for Japanese veterans due to this. It swept under the rugs the brutalities of war and colonization in favor of the tropical paradise that was Jawa. A Jawa that could have been theirs if they had not lost the war. In the 1951 Kon Ichikawa film, Bungawan Soro, you can see here now that the song was used to that effect. The legacy of this song as a vehicle for colonial nostalgia still persists in our current contemporary era. Most recently, Bungawan Solo was featured in a Japanese theater production called Southern Cross, or Minami Jujise, in 2004. The play is a doomed romance between a Japanese soldier and a Javanese woman in Bali. This Pocahontas-esque doomed romance is enshrouded in fetishization, featuring an exotic native as the heroine, placing a focus on the otherness of Indonesia, while reconfiguring Japan's role as the colonizer into that of a victim. This is demonstrated by a scene where a character is executed for being wrongly charged of human rights abuses. For the greater part of the 20th century, many Japanese musicians and the population were not actually aware of the song's Indonesian origin, and thought of it as their own. That was until Indonesian copyright laws caught up with the many versions of Bungawan Solo that paid no royalties. Indonesian lawyers sued those Japanese musicians for intellectual property breaches. Kasang won and came out far wealthier than he had ever been in his life. Finally, we can talk about how Bungawan Solo became so popular overseas, especially in Southeast and East Asia. Let's first ask an important question. Why Bungawan Solo? What made this song in particular special compared to other songs from the same era, which became famous internationally and were also translated into multiple languages? After all, Bungawan Solo was not the only song this had happened to. For example, we can take a popular song like Quizás, Quizás, Quizás by Cuban songwriter Osvaldo Fardez, and originally sung by Bobby Capó in 1947. The song was turned into covers by Nat King Cole and was also translated into English with the title Perhaps, 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 and was sung by singers like Doris Day. To explain, songwriting was not really common for singers in that era worldwide. It was not until the likes of the Beatles, who popularized writing every song in an album themselves, that there was a shift. Instead, cover songs of other musicians were far more common, as they were an easy way to market an artist into the mainstream with a familiar melody. If you were a fan of, say, Frank Sinatra, then you would definitely hear many cover songs. This doesn't mean that artists didn't write songs back then, it was just more popular to cover them instead. Tall, tan, young, lovely, the girl from Ipanema goes walking, and when she passes, I smile, but she doesn't see. However, Bungawan Solo was special due to its history, as we discussed, and its reach into the Pan-Asian identity and zeitgeist. After the Dutch left in 1949, Bungawan Solo could be heard frequently on Radio Republik Indonesia, a national radio station founded after the proclamation of independence. President Sukarno also instructed Indonesian ambassadors overseas to promote the song throughout the 1950s. In other versions throughout Asia, the translations of the lyrics turned Bungawan Solo into a romantic love song. Most notably, Rebecca Pan's version in Hong Kong, which also famously appeared in Wong Kar-wai's 2000 masterpiece, In the Mood for Love, reimagined the River of Solo as a place where lovers meet and is a nostalgic tune of a time that came before. All the translations of the song, whether reconfigured as a love song or as a simple nostalgic tune, spark this feeling of an imagined heyday of a time that came before, especially if listened to now. Bungoman Solo is a song with an everlasting legacy, both in Indonesia and internationally. Domestically in Indonesia, various musicians have covered the song right up to the present day. In China, the song has been popular since the war, and in Hong Kong and Singapore, the song was translated into both Mandarin and Cantonese. Bungoman Solo has been sung in Tagalog in the Philippines, in Khmer in Cambodia, and has versions in Myanmar, Thailand, Vietnam, and more. All of these countries have localized the song to fit their own national identity and style, morphing its meaning each time, while somewhat interestingly still holding on to the Indonesia-specific title, Bungoman Solo. In the West, the song was also released in the original Indonesia Krongcong version by musicians in the Netherlands. The song's brilliance and soothing melody were surely good reasons for the spread, but its history and iconic status in the Pan-Asian zeitgeist post-World War II remain significant. Many of these countries were former colonies themselves, and the song's inextricable link to colonization must have resonated with these countries' struggles and search for self-determination. While perhaps waning in popularity and frozen within an era of previous generations, you can still find subtle hints of the song's iconic status throughout Southeast Asia. For example, if you are Singaporean, you would probably know the name Bungoman Solo from a bakery chain in your country, which has 45 branches nationwide. The song will forever embody Indonesia and Asia's struggle with colonial independence, with its rustic and down-to-earth melody that can be adopted by any culture, yet still resonate within the hearts of its listeners. For this reason, Bungoman Solo should continue to be remembered and celebrated. Thank you for watching. This mini-doc is brought to you by broadly-pacific.com. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And be sure to follow us on our website and social media. If you want to directly support us and gain bonuses like early access, work in progresses, shout-outs, and more, consider supporting us on patreon.com/broadly_specific. Thank you to all our patrons, and see you next time.